the following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Wait a minute. Do you still think politics is boring? Well, not when you can say fun words like caucus. Yes, it's fun words like caucus and more. With the intellectual, intersexual, and intersectional, Nicole Sandler on NicoleSandler.com.
I'm so excited to welcome Marcy Wheeler back to the show and to announce that she's going to be joining us more regularly because, oh my God, there's so much to talk about. So the next couple of weeks are going to be weird because you're on vacation and I'm moving, but we will get to a weekly session where we can go through everything that's going on because it's so hard to keep track of it all. Somehow you do, Marcy Wheeler. And the thing that amazes me whenever we talk, I throw questions at you. I don't ever tell you ahead of time what I'm going to ask you. And you seem to just always know the answers. Do you do any special like brain exercises to keep things straight?
No, I write a lot. I mean, you know, I write. You talk to people on your show a lot. I write a lot. So right. Whatever.
Yeah. In fact, we are taping this as we tend to do because you're in Ireland and I'm here on the East Coast, not for long, but here. And so
in Florida.
Oh, can't wait. And I don't know if you watched the debate the other night, but we can talk about that for a few minutes if you like. What kills me is a Washington Post Ipsos poll had DeSantis coming out on top, like he won the debate with Vivek Ramaswamy coming in second. It really is opposite world. There's no explanation as far as
I'm concerned. It's opposite world, but like this is my new theory on politics. No one should be writing about polls because polls are meaningless. Mm-hmm. First of all, polls are meaningless always this far out from an election, but like you cannot write about what Trump voters are going to do, what MAGAs are going to do, unless you first describe that those MAGAs are all inside this media bubble. And so, like, you and I don't understand how DeSantis has any credibility, or Ramaswamy, or anybody
right? Like, on that stage, right?
But we don't live on Fox News and in this right-wing trollosphere, and so we can't. You know, like, because I write about Hunter Biden as well as all the Trump stuff, it's like I'm acutely aware of the fact that the real world, including like the entire world, is like, you know, Donald Trump got his mugshot taken yesterday. That's the news that the real world is seeing. And Fox News is like, Hunter Biden flew on a plane, you know, and it's crazy. But these people literally believe that Hunter Biden flying on a plane is equivalent to the 91 felony charges against Donald Trump. They literally believe that. And they believe that because they've been brainwashed. And unless you understand that brainwashing process, you cannot understand what's going to happen with politics. Like one of the most, and I need to find the citation because it's one of the most important observations I've read recently, which is that of Fox viewers, there's, you know, maybe let's say 55% never watch anything but Fox News.
It's astounding.
But then about 30% or so also watch their local broadcast news. And that 30% is the only part of the Republican base that is reachable. That 30% is the part of the Republican base that may believe Hunter Biden flying on a plane is equivalent to 91 felony charges. But they also may also realize that Republicans took away the right to abortion, or that Republicans refused to do anything about climate change, or that, you know, actually the border has gotten more secure, or that actually Democratic cities have declining murder rates compared especially to rural areas, you know? Mm-hmm. And so that is the state of America right now, is that you've got this amazing bubble and the brainwashing is really incomprehensible to the rest of us, I think.
I'm incredulous. I mean, even watching the debate and then seeing the comments afterwards, these people live in a different world. But here we are. It is Friday now, Friday morning. And last night, Donald Trump orchestrated it so he'd be booked during prime cable time. And, you know, look, there was nothing you could see except this ridiculous motorcade. Do all former presidents have motorcades like that when they go somewhere? Does the media focus on the plane and the 10 cars and the whole thing?
That's the discussion this morning, is that Barack Obama can go places with 2-3 SUVs. I assume we're going to learn more about the motorcade. I assume we're going to learn that many media outlets had some seat on the motorcade, because they did the last time Trump was arraigned. But same thing. You know, he's getting very good at being arrested. He's getting very good at playing it up. And he gives inside peeks to kind of chosen journalists. He's turned the OJ car chase into a brand. And he, look on the bright side. And yes, you have that kind of motorcade, but also look on the bright side. We've been through four criminal arrests of some sort or another. I mean, they're legally different things, but we've been through four of them, mm-hmm. and we have yet to have a riot tied to them. So breathe a sigh of relief, because I think we narrowly missed something. And, you know, maybe all of the arrests of the crime scene people that DOJ has been still working on. I mean, every day they still churn new arrests of people who assaulted cops on January 6th. Maybe these arrests actually are having an effect. And now that we're arresting the white collar people, maybe those will have an effect too.
Well, I hope so. And I think the arrests we've had so far haven't really produced mugshots. Well, now we got the mugshots. And I think that makes a world of difference. First of all, the news, the breaking news headlines last night everywhere. This is the very first time a president, former or current, has ever been mugshotted. And I love this. So there's the mugshot of Trump. And it's what you'd expect. But somebody... I guess it was June Coey. There's this tweet that I saw that says that it's a Kubrick stare. And they put, you know, Malcolm McDowell from Clockwork Orange and Jack Nicholson from The Shining. And I don't even know who this other guy is. But that's the look that Trump is giving. So that's the news, you know, that was the big headline last night. But more importantly, I think, well, not more importantly, but equally important, there's Rudy Giuliani. And, Sidney Powell and the smiling Jenna Ellis. What?
So I recommend, and maybe you can find it, and well, you can't link anything on Shitter anymore, but right. If you go to Shitter, there's been a couple of very good threads about historic mugshots of politicians. One was by Eric Columbus.
Okay.
Like it sounds. E-R-I-C Columbus. Like okay. It sounds. He was a lawyer associated with the January 6th committee, but as yesterday was rolling out, he rolled out a long stream of politicians' mugshots. And his theory is the ones who smile get off, starting with the famous filet one. So Jenna Ellis is gonna get off.
Oh, interesting.
But all these other scowls, because most of them are scowls. Most of them, they right? look psychopaths. You know, they're all psychopaths. They yep. all, you know, I worry about them.
Yeah, there's the Tom DeLay one. And yeah, and he went on to Dancing with the Stars. So, you know.
Right, that. Tom DeLay, and then John Edwards.
Oh, John Edwards, yeah. Who's this? Larry Craig. He's the toe tapper. I am not gay. I never have been gay. Blagojevich. Alabama Governor Robert Bentley. I don't remember him. But this is great.
Oh. This is why this. Yeah, and Rick Perry got off,
Rick
too.
Perry.
So his theory is if you smile as a corrupt politician, you get off. But all of those scowl people, they're destined for jail. That's why I thought I'd share it, because it's a good theory. The other thing is now there's this ridiculous journalism beat, which of course includes Maggie Haberman.
Yes.
Where everyone's like, oh, let's see at these, you know, like they're turning it into a cross of People Magazine and TMZ. But
yeah,
which is Maggie's desired beat, like a cross of People Magazine and TMZ.
And that's remember, she's sharing the byline on this piece with Glenn Thrush, who was already like demoted at the Post and I think at Politico, because he's not like a good guy and he's kind of sexist and an asshole. But they have a shared byline from yesterday afternoon. The traditional mugshot is usually a grim affair, poorly lit and sullen. And it's a whole thing about the mugshots. And really?
And let me interject here because this is important. And I guess today I'm going to highlight the names of some people who people should follow just to remember, like, you know, prosecutors aren't heroes necessarily. Like, our criminal justice system it has a lot of problems, and mugshots are one of those problems. I mean, like, the mugshots were designed by people like Rudy Giuliani. So you're allowed to spread Rudy Giuliani's all you want, especially because the mugshots of Lev Parnas and Igor Fruman, both Floridians, they got spread around everywhere. And Rudy never got his mugshot from that Ukraine caper. So, right. But people like Rudy Giuliani years ago masterminded the perp walk, masterminded the dehumanization of people who are being arrested. And so, well, I think, you know, of course, Donald Trump's mugshot is historic and Rudy Giuliani's, you can do whatever the hell you want to do with Rudy Giuliani's mugshot. He deserves it.
Fun with
it. You know, it's worth remembering that the mugshot, like, yeah, we like that Fannie Willis is forcing these people to go through and be treated like everybody else. And that does matter. I mean, I think it's giving people who've lost faith that criminal justice is applied equally in this country some faith that it is. We'll see. You know, these people are going to have very good lawyers, and it's going to be a contest all the way through. However, you know, we've been watching criminal investigations for 2.5 years now. As we begin to watch criminal prosecutions, it's really important to remember the importance of due process, the ways in which our criminal justice system dehumanizes people who go through it. And remember that these are many of them rich white people. The only person so far who did not make bail among Trump's co-conspirators is this guy, Willie Floyd, who happens to be one of the two black co-defendants.
Interesting.
We don't know why he didn't make bail yet. My suspicion has to do with finding a lawyer, because what everyone is doing is arranging their bail conditions before they go in, and so they go in and just get processed and get to go home, whereas for whatever reason, Willie Floyd showed up. Willie Floyd also got arrested earlier this year, unbeknownst, like, it took a week for Washington Post to cover it, and they may have been tipped off, but, like, Willie Floyd was arrested he was arrested in Maryland in February, and then arrested by the FBI in May for assaulting two FBI agents trying to serve a Jack Smith subpoena back in February. So he's the guy, he's Black Voices for Trump, who was involved in the pressure campaign against Ruby Freeman. So
he's
still in jail, last we checked.
So, and you have a couple of pieces about him up at emptywheel.net, and you seem to be the only one talking about him. It's like no one's paying attention to this guy who is the only one who hasn't made bail yet. The whole thing is just,
well, not just him. I'm also paying attention, like I made an argument the day before that, that this other guy, Scott Hall, who we don't know, he's a Georgian, you know, we don't know him. He's a bail bondsman.
Right. He was the first one.
He's one of the people who's kind of a parasite of this criminal justice system, now going through it himself. But, you know, there's this sense that the Georgia indictment is three separate plots. There's the fake elector plot. There's the Coffee County stealing the tabulator data plot, which is Sidney Powell's gig. And then there's the pressure on Ruby Freeman. And if you actually look at the Ruby Freeman stuff, it all overlaps. The GOP chair is involved. This guy, the bail bondsman, who happens to be David Bossie's brother-in-law. So, you know, these things are going to end up being more closely networked than we imagined. But it's people like that. It's people like the bail bondsman that you don't know about that connect them all together.
He was the first one to turn himself in and be bailed out. And so those mugshots are going around. One of my favorite memes that I saw was someone took like the first nine of them and put them in the boxes and said, this reboot of the Brady Bunch doesn't look very good. But then I also like this one where it's fun with Photoshop. And I get what you're saying. That these people are presumed innocent until proven guilty. They have the good day in court. But we need some comic relief because we're all stressed out by everything that's going on. So
and understand about Trump's. And there's going to be this contest going forward. Trump doesn't own that mugshot. Trump is trying to, you know, like I woke up in the middle of the night. I was like, oh, God, the mug. But, you know, I was thinking they were going to release the mugshot today with the rest of them. No, they released it. And Trump already had merch, right?
Right. At
$47 T-shirts for his mugshot. And he's trying to undercut, like he's trying to kind of, like I said, brand the OJ car chase. But he doesn't own that. And so, again, you can do whatever you want with Rudy's. You can do whatever you want with Trump's. And it's important to brand Trump's, I think, because he likes owning his own brand. And his mugshot is something that he doesn't own.
Right. No, that's a really good point. But see, he doesn't understand the difference because he thinks he owns all those documents that he took that he doesn't own either. But you got to really, you know, he knew this was coming and he practiced that this was the look he was going to.
The psychopathic scare.
Right. Yeah. So this was intentional.
He's
a sad, sad person. So,
but
okay.
Can you go back to that?
Yeah, sure. Easily
and then,
here.
And then flip maybe to the Sidney Powell ones is okay. Like, I also think the Fulton County people, like the lighting on that is pretty good. Now, if you go back to the Sidney Powell one.
Uh-huh. Yeah, she's
like the lighting on those is terrible. Yeah. Look at that glare off Sidney Powell and that big glare off Rudy's hair. And then so I think the Fulton County people are like, let me slowly perfect the mugshot because these are gonna last forever. So
they are. But now, okay. So now we were told Donald Trump is going to be treated just like everyone else. But was everybody else given the opportunity to make up a height and weight? Yeah, and hair color, so nobody had to step on the scale. They got
no, but you know what I learned this morning is Jeffrey Clark is
5'3". 5'3" and 150
pounds. He's such a nut. Yeah, 5'3".
Napoleon complex, I mean,
Nicole,
or something.
When you go to D.C., like you've done this, right? You go to D.C. and you stand next to somebody waiting for an elevator, and you're like, I had no idea you were shorter than me. Men, like the men who run the world are these short D.C. men who have Napoleon complex.
That's
and
right.
You don't understand that until you're waiting for an elevator next to them, I swear.
Or and they so get
Jeffrey
arrested
Clark,
and
Jeffrey
have...
Clark, I'd be looking down at Jeffrey Clark. I'm several inches taller than Jeffrey
that's
Clark.
Hysterical. And that's hysterical. So, but Donald Trump, you know, if you needed evidence that the man lies every time he opens his mouth, I love this. First, when he was arraigned, I guess, in March, he said that he was 6'2" and 240 pounds. Now, according to him, he's 6'3" and 215, which is hysterical. No, he's not. And his hair is strawberry blonde, don't you know?
Well, I mean, it's whatever comes out of the bottle. So yeah, he can claim that.
Of course.
I actually, there's a Floridian who's on the lam right now. This guy, Chris Worrell, who is a proud boy. He's from Tampa, I think. And he was about to be sentenced and then went on the lam. So there's wanted posters of him going out. And he's exactly the same size as Donald Trump, which I realize, like, he's one of these proud boys. He's just a toxic person. He's one of the proud boys who sprayed the cops, but also just your big, big proud boy guy. Like, he's got coins of Donald Trump's face coins. Like, he has a challenge coin made up of January 6th itself, like a proud boy commemorative coin. So anyway, that dude is on the loose around you, Nicole. And that dude, I think he said his weight was 240. But you look at him, you're like, oh, God, this is what Donald Trump would be if he were not born to wealth and also in Florida. Oh, wait, they're both in Florida. So and Chris Worrell's case ties closely to Roger Stone. So they're you know, 2 degrees of Roger Stone.
Why is Roger Stone missing from this Georgia indictment?
Well, we're going to get David Bossy before we get Roger Stone, but that's almost the same, isn't it? Look, I think with Roger Stone, first of all, like, Roger Stone is one of the people that you get to from both sides, right?
Right.
Like, Roger Stone has very well-developed relationships, especially with the Proud Boys, less so with the Oath Keepers, but also with the Oath Keepers, also with another militia group, and then obviously with Donald Trump and Ali Alexander and Alex Jones. And I think that to get to Roger Stone, a number of things have to happen first. And one thing that has to happen first is you have to get through the Proud Boys. Mm-hmm. The Proud Boys sentencing is next week. DOJ is asking for very steep terrorist enhancements for them. So they're looking for sentences upwards of what Stuart Rhodes was sentenced to. And it's a hard issue because they didn't personally engage in some of the worst violence. They just elicited the violence from hundreds and hundreds of people. So that's coming up next week. And Owen Schroyer, Alex Jones's sidekick, uh-huh. is also due to be sentenced, I think, in early September. And there are a few other things that I anticipate are going on behind the scenes, some of which are unfortunate, some of the like Cassandra stuff I was yelling about 2 years ago. But so you have to, I think those are the cases. Roger Stone, Alex Jones are the cases. Alex Jones especially, because Alex yes. Jones, they both, Alex Jones and Roger Stone, are very good at laying alibis. So was Taddeo. But Taddeo is closer to the action. And so you need to have a lot to combat whatever alibi they have for the time they're arrested. Like, you know, Alex Jones, right, he staged this claim that he was trying to de-escalate the violence at the Capitol when obviously he wasn't. That argument has already been debunked, but only debunked so far as to sustain a trespassing charge for Owen Schroyer built off of a pre-existing non-prosecution agreement. And so you need to get further with Alex Jones, and it takes a lot of work to get there and a lot of, you know, just as one example, Roger Stone is somebody who in real time was using self-deleting signal texts, whereas both the Proud Boys and Oath Keepers, they tried to delete stuff after the fact, uh-huh. but they weren't deleting it as they go. And so those make it harder to prosecute.
Yeah. So they're all in the works. You think there are active investigations still going on that are looking at those guys, at Roger Stone and Alex Jones and Ali Alexander, people we haven't seen named?
Roger Stone, I have no doubt. I mean, one of the things that Chris Worrell, the guy who's on the lam, you know, hunting in your neighborhood right now, like literally, he was convicted of both assault and obstruction. They're asking for a 14-year sentence for him. And the way in which they got to premeditation for obstruction was that on the 3rd, January 3rd, in Florida, he and Roger Stone were hanging out calling for the noose for Rick Scott if he didn't if he didn't side with the challenges. So that's the, like, when you see the centrality of Roger Stone in Chris Worrell's sentencing, you see that they definitely are building that case. I mean, again, I think they'd like to have Worrell sentenced before they go after and try and arrest Roger Stone as well. But
okay. Well, so and last week when we spoke, we went through basically the four cases against Trump. Now, the Georgia one, the most recent one, and the one that they're all, today is a deadline for them to turn themselves in. Still, a few haven't, but a few fought it, like Mark Meadows. Now, Mark Meadows. It's interesting, since he's been so quiet, many of us, myself included, assumed that he was probably cooperating with Jack Smith, because he wasn't indicted in that case, but he was charged in Georgia. He tried to get it moved back to federal court. They said, no, doesn't work that way. And he finally yesterday went in and got mugshotted. Guy looks like he is
also a psychopath.
Crying.
but there's the lighting problem I told you uh-huh. about. Like uh-huh. that's a lighting problem. They fixed that before Trump. Or Trump wore better makeup.
Trump wore better makeup. But Mark Meadows, he looks like he was just crying and was about to cry again. And I guess, you know, that's what happens when you break the law and you think you're above it. So the Mark Meadows is now indicted. He's now booked. He's a prisoner they're out on bail. They're all out on bond.
He's a pretrial release felon. Yeah. Felonies. Defendant. In fact, the next thing after we get done with our mugshots, I think there's just one person who hasn't turned themselves in, which is the because a bunch did this morning. Okay. One is, it's that minister, the kind of right-wing Lutheran minister who was also involved in the Ruby Freeman pressure campaign, who I think has ties to Rudy and Carrick through his police networks. But anyway, the next big event is Monday. So Mark Meadows, did I tell you that Mark Meadows was not cooperating? I think I did.
No, I think you did. Yes, you did. But we thought he was because he was so quiet. He did that unusual thing for these Republicans. He listened to what his lawyer said and he shut his mouth.
Yeah. Yeah. And I wrote, if people didn't see over last weekend, I wrote what I think is a really good, like, here's what we can tell from Mark Meadows. And I think what happened is Mark Meadows early on was trying to keep his options open and not go on the record. And he was interviewed in the stolen documents case probably before the search in Florida. Okay. And he kind of denied certain things that after the prosecution developed, probably in a grand jury appearance in April, at least a grand jury appearance in April, he was like, oh yeah, you know, now I believe that my ghostwriter was right and that Donald Trump was wrong. So his, you know, what has probably happened is he has slowly evolved his testimony such that he hasn't been named as a co-conspirator in the federal case. We'll see how it works now that there are two. So he's trying, he and Jeffrey Clark, and Trump presumably will, but last I checked, it wasn't filed yet. I saw something this morning that said it may have been, but
they're both trying
to remove their prosecutions to federal court, as are a couple of the fake electors. And Mark Meadows and Jeffrey Clark, it's not frivolous for them. I mean, for better or worse, the U.S. government says if you are a federal government employee and you do something, the states can't be arresting you for doing something that's part of your job. So if Mark Meadows and Jeffrey Clark can argue it was part of our job to try and steal the election in Georgia, then what'll happen is first it'll get their case will get they'll just get to be tried in federal court, and Mark Meadows is trying to have it dismissed entirely. And as you said, Mark Meadows has really good lawyers.
Mm-hmm. And he's listening to them.
He has been a remarkably good client of his really good lawyers. And that's one of many reasons I say this is not a frivolous challenge on his part. But his really good lawyers said they tried to get everything in place before the arrest happened. And they failed. Fannie Willis wrote this great letter, which you probably have somewhere, where she was like, your client is no different from any other defendant in this district. And yours in service, she signed it with this very floral signature. So they tried to get it all in place before the actual arrest went in, and Fannie Willis won that fight. She won the fight to say, like, you as a federal judge cannot prevent me from carrying out a prosecution in my district until after you've seen the evidence. So Mark Meadows' very good lawyers jumped on it very quickly, and his hearing for the evidence is on Monday.
Ah, so that's what, now again, this is in Georgia, so will this be televised?
No, it's a no, because it's a federal hearing? Court.
This is in the federal court. Okay.
Yeah, everything, once we get to the Georgia State Court, and the first that we are scheduled to be in the Georgia State Court besides arraignments is Kenneth Cheeseborough asked for a speedy trial, so for October 23rd.
Yeah, okay.
But
yes.
Is now scheduled for October 23rd.
Wow. So, okay. So let's go there. So Kenneth Cheeseborough, he is one of
Let me do the Mark Meadows thing first.
Okay.
It's Monday.
Yes.
And it is
Monday.
This is a good read for people of Mark Meadows.
Okay.
On Monday, Brad Raffensperger and the investigator for the state of Georgia and one other witness will go to that hearing, and Fannie Willis's prosecutors will get them to, will elicit testimony from them. So you're going to see Brad Raffensperger testify on Monday about that phone call, the January 2nd phone call from Donald Trump. You're going to see, I'm forgetting her last name, Frances Watson, I think is her name. You're going to see her testify to what Mark Meadows did on December 22nd, 2020, when he came down and tried to get into the area where they were comparing signatures. You're going to see her testify about a conversation they had on the 23rd. And this is where Mark Meadows is. So he pled the fifth mostly in the grand jury in Georgia. He was forced to testify to executive privilege stuff in DC. And this is where Mark Meadows' testimony may kind of could start to fall apart. Because if you look at the Georgia evidence, it looks like Mark Meadows came, tried to bulldoze his way in, was prevented, and then went back to DC and said, I was prevented, let's go pressure them some more. Mark Meadows told a DC grand jury that he went back to DC and told Trump everything's in order.
Right.
So, and for Jack Smith's purposes, that testimony is perfectly fine. It means another high level Trump aide told him everything was in order, and Trump nevertheless still doubled down. But it may not be entirely accurate. And so Monday we actually get testimony from three Georgia witnesses, and we see how well Fannie Willis's prosecutors stand up against probably the best. Well, Trump has a very good Georgia lawyer as of yesterday, but some of the best lawyers of any of the 19 co-conspirators. So gotcha. Happening Monday.
Okay, but we won't actually see it. We'll hear about it because this is the federal.
Hear a ton of real coverage. That's a federal courthouse in Atlanta.
Okay. All right. So Cheeseborough or Chesboro, however you say his name, he was one of the
cheese man.
I say cheese because he's kind of cheesy. Anyway, so he said, okay, Fannie Willis said, we're going to try all 19 of these co-defendants together. Cheeseborough said, I want to go for my speedy trial. And she said, okay, great. We'll do October 23rd. So leading some to say that that's what the holdup was in the, you know, months ago, Fannie Willis said the indictment is imminent. And then months went by. I think it was Rachel Maddow said she was dotting her I's and crossing her T's and getting everything ready so she can go to court immediately. She's ready. So she wants to get this done because, well, it's a whole other story. But so now will this be severed from the other ones? They can't make the other ones go on October 23rd. As well?
We'll see. So she asked to put all 19 on that date, and Trump immediately filed and said, we don't want that date.
No, we want 2026.
So this is where I think there may be some slide, and we'll see. We'll see, right? Because she's going to say this is a conspiracy and they should all be tried together. Yeah, we'll see. As of right now, Cheeseboro is scheduled for October 23rd. And I think he'd like to be severed. He's going to get up and argue that he was just the paperwork guy. He was just providing advice and Trump followed, you know, it wasn't up. He didn't implement the advice. Where he had more direct contact with people was in Wisconsin and Arizona than Georgia, I think. Well, yeah, we'll see. Okay. You know, there's a lot. October is still a long way away, but there's still a lot that could happen between now and then. Like Cheeseboro hasn't been charged in federal court yet, and it could happen. And if and when that does happen, you know, he may rethink rushing to get himself on the record, as John Eastman is currently doing. John Eastman is currently in his debarment hearings in California. So he keeps going on the record. Today and yesterday.
Yep.
He had to fly back to Georgia to be arrested so that he can go back to be debarred.
Oh my God.
And but, meanwhile, I mean, these things are going to start interacting like this more and more.
Are we going to hear when the co-conspirators individually start flipping, or will they wait to spring that on us like a trial? Will we know ahead of time if somebody's cooperating?
I don't know. I honestly, there are some really good experts in Georgia that I really defer to. Like Anna Bauer is one that might be familiar because she's at Lawfare.
Right.
But the Atlantic Journal Constitution has a lot of good coverage that I can't see because it's GDPR protected. There's a fair number of Georgians who know the local court, know the local law, know the local personalities. And I think we're getting in some ways better coverage out of Georgia because people who know the law are covering it rather than just dipshit political reporters like are covering the DC trials.
So. Uh-huh. Now, you started telling us before who we should follow. I know I have Anna Bauer, the Atlanta Journal Constitution. Anybody else that you're saying that this person's providing really good coverage we should listen to?
I'm going to forget a few of them, but Georgia Public Broadcasting, I think his name is Stephen Fowler, Stephen with a PH.
Okay.
And there's an attorney whose name I'm going to forget. Let me see if I can find it, but he's also really good. And I'm going to keep recommending that people go to the Georgia coverage because it's just better. It's better. It's going to be better coverage because they're there. These are the people who are going to cover Monday's hearing. It's better coverage because it's better steeped in the law and the local personalities. And so especially on the Georgia coverage, I really recommend that you seek out Georgia experts because it's there and you're just going to know, you're going to have much better information than if you, CNN's doing, like CNN and ABC, I think are doing good coverage generally of Trump's prosecutions across the board. But they're just not, they don't have the expertise that the Georgians do. And so go with the Georgians for the Georgia case. Because
Sounds good.
State case too. It's a different, it's different.
Right. Okay. So Marcy Wheeler is here. When we started, last week I asked you, all right, now the four indictments that we were expecting have have happened. Now we move forward because are there any more? We don't know. Well, this morning, I'm sure others are reporting it too, but Rolling Stone is reporting that Arizona is probing Rudy Giuliani, so to speak, as, quote, fake elector kingpin. I'm hearing all kinds of stuff that there's something brewing in Arizona. Have you heard anything about that? More charges?
It's just another investigation, and it, so we're not going to get another investigation in Vegas because of the way their law goes. Mm-hmm. We're not in Pennsylvania and Wisconsin because those people were smart enough to protect themselves. Which state am I missing? Georgia, Wisconsin, Michigan. We've got Michigan. So Michigan, the charges are just at the state level.
Right. And
so
they've already indicted, all of the fake electors there.
And also the equivalent of the Coffee County thing, the stealing the data. And you could see parallels to those charges in Arizona, because in Arizona, again, you have both. You've got the effort to get the data, which was really sustained and probably borrowed the Dominion data from Coffee County and from Antrim County and the stuff from Michigan. So Michigan got it first, then Georgia, and then it all went to Arizona. And then the fake electors you have people like Mark Fincham, who there are a couple figures who have ties to the Stop the Steal and also to the fake electors. Mark Fincham is that person in Arizona.
Yeah.
And he really like, Ali Alexander, his closest ties at a state level were to Arizona. So he has close ties to Paul Gosar's office. He has ties to Mark Fincham. So that would be, I did a thread overnight about this, and I've written about this a couple of times, but what's going to increasingly happen and what may cause this to snowball, either politically or legally, is that, even in Georgia versus the state, you've got areas where there's uneven coverage, like Mark Meadows is charged in Georgia, but not charged federally. Or Sidney Powell is exposed. Her charges in Georgia are pretty significant. They're hacking charges, basically. So she's go get the data. And she's not yet charged, of course, federally. But federally, all she is described as doing is filing lawsuits focusing on Dominion. Hmm. Whereas in Georgia, she's accused of hacking. basically. Wow. And she, you know, so the Georgia charges aren't pardonable, and she's accused of a far more serious crime in Georgia than she is currently described as doing on the federal level. And so if you're Sidney Powell, do you flip and help make this case? Or like the Willie Floyd that I told you about, right? So he was arrested for assaulting FBI guys trying to serve a subpoena, and his docket in Maryland just disappears on May 15th. Like May 19th. We don't know what happened after he submitted his passport on May 19th. We don't know what happened. And so presumably something happened there that suggests that Jack Smith was investigating the Ruby Freeman stuff back in February, but we don't know much about that either. You know, what is Willie Floyd going to do after a night in the awful Fulton County jail? The one, right. You know, one of the two black people who actually didn't get bailed. So that's one thing. But the other thing is, and this is more true, far more true in Georgia than Arizona or Michigan. But again, I keep saying this. In Georgia, the party stood up to Donald Trump.
Yes.
Right? In Georgia, you're going to have Brad Raffensperger testify. You're going to have an elected official testify against Mark Meadows on Monday. And in Georgia, which had always been Republican until Donald Trump came along, mm-hmm. Those same people standing up to Donald Trump have lost three elections.
That's right.
They lost both Senate seats. They lost the presidential and Warnock again, right? Walker.
Exactly.
Against a Trump candidate. Like, you know, probably they could have had a better Georgia candidate. They brought Herschel Walker in. He proved to be totally corrupt, totally hypocritical. And so, you know, my one and in Georgia, unlike Michigan, Michigan, all the fake electors have been charged.
Right.
So they're not, you know, they had a pool party to celebrate. They're like a club together and they're nuts. Like Michigan's Republican Party is significantly more nuts than Georgia for a variety of reasons. But the people who run it right now are just batshit insane. Whereas Georgia, there are some extremely conservative people who would like to have their extremely conservative lives back. And the question is, and many of those people are testifying and may testify against Kenneth Chesebrough on October 23rd, well before we start getting into primaries. And Trump cannot become president again unless he wins Georgia.
Right. Right.
Or not any foreseeable means, you know, like the math doesn't work. If he doesn't win Georgia, he's not going to be president again. And so I'm not promising that the Republican Party is going to split from Donald Trump. The chances of that happening are still low. But even if just the Republican Party in Georgia uses this as an opportunity to totally distance themselves from Trump, if only to regain their state as a Republican state,
right?
You know, as a non-Trump Republican state, we're going to see interesting things happening with the politics and things that we really can't foresee. We can't. I mean, like a point I made in this thread overnight is that one of the most important witnesses, if Jack Smith can get the DC case to trial before the primaries or before Super Tuesday, one of the most important witnesses in that case is not Stephen Miller, the other one.
Jason Miller.
Jason Miller. Yeah, it's Jason Miller.
Yeah.
Because Jason Miller has this habit of telling the truth. And so what is it going to, how is it going to work if, say, Donald Trump is going to trial in February on that federal charge and Jason Miller is a dead drop witness against Donald, and Mark Meadows right now is signed up to be a witness against Donald Trump. How's that going to work? How's that going to affect the primary? I don't know. No one knows.
No.
But those are the kinds of questions that we should be asking in addition to asking how do you get those Fox viewers out of that bubble?
Right. So we've got the Georgia case, which is in full swing now. It's like, all right, took the imminence. It took forever, but it's there, and now it's all imminent. You got Jack Smith and the January 6th case, but you also have Jack Smith and the documents case. Now, there was action in the documents case this week where Usil, I don't know his last name, the IT guy,
Tavares, yeah.
Tavares flipped. He's like, fired the Trump attorney who you told us about last time, who's representing too many of them, conflict of interest. He fired him and then got a new attorney and went in and recanted his false statement and saying, what do we know about this?
Well, and saying, I mean, one of the things, look, we have completely lost track that normally in criminal investigations, a great many people go in and testify truthfully because we've become inured to Donald Trump, like where everyone believes they have impunity. And so there was an ABC report. Again, ABC does good reporting on this kind of stuff. There was an ABC report that he wasn't so much instructed to lie as he just wanted to not be involved. And so his original testimony was not forthcoming about this effort to destroy surveillance footage. And the lawyer in question, a guy by the name of Stan Woodward, right, being paid Stan by Woodward, Trump's PAC, representing 8 witnesses in the documents case alone.
Wow.
And including people like Cash Patel.
Right.
And he has part of Peter Navarro's defense. Navarro is defended by everyone. But and so because Tavares's false testimony was in D.C., they had to deal with it in D.C. They were either going to charge him with perjury, and they sent him a target letter that said, we're going to charge you with perjury, and then told the chief judge in D.C. that he was being represented by an attorney with all these conflicts. He's, again, 8. At that point, it was 8. Now right, it's 7. And the chief judge, Jeb Boasberg, brought in the public defenders, the federal defenders, probably a woman named Shelley Peterson, who's just a superb lawyer. Anyone would love to have her if they could. And under her advice, and he didn't have to flip. So he didn't have to enter into a plea agreement. And this was probably Jack Smith trying to break the wall, right? Mm-hmm. You get one or two key witnesses and others may decide that they don't want to go to jail for Donald Trump. And so all he had to do was recant his testimony. And he gave very damning testimony about not just Trump and Walt Nauta, who had already been charged, but also Carlos de Oliveira, and now DOJ has noticed conflicts, both the 7 people who Stan Woodward represent. And in their most recent filing, which was this week, they said, you know, we had to go to Boasberg about it, not just because of these conflicting witnesses, but because he's being paid by Trump, basically. And mm-hmm. So there's a conflict about whether he's representing Walt Nauta's interests or representing Trump's. And then also with De Oliveira, that lawyer, John Irving, represents 3 witnesses in the case. And so they've done the same thing with him. And Aileen Cannon, who's not a very experienced judge, was like, oh, let me complain about the way you're using grand juries. Right. And DOJ's response was like, if you do what Stan Woodward wants you to do, it will be reversible error. If you do not give a conflict notice to these two defendants, it will be a reversible error. And so they're basically threatening to go to the 11th Circuit, and particularly on what Stan Woodward wants, it would be easily reversed. It would be like, you know, the smackdown she got from the 11th Circuit last fall. And so, you know, again, like when I say these all work together, if Jack, like the documents case may not go to trial until May or maybe next October or what have you, but if Jack Smith can use that case to break all of these conflicted attorney relationships, it's going to have an effect on the DC case as well, because they're the same people.
Right. So that's the thing. My next question was going to be, and so what's happening with Aileen Cannon? Because they did the indictment here, and now he's doing a grand jury thing in DC, and that's not cool. I'm obviously paraphrasing in how I envision her doing this, but there was nothing wrong with how they had this. I guess it was all about Tavares in D.C., and there was no problem there. What's happening with Aileen Cannon? Is she's going forward? She's going to be the judge? Does she seem to know what she's doing?
No, she doesn't. I mean, she's inexperienced. She's not unqualified to be a judge. She is inexperienced, as, by the way, is the Georgia judge who
right.
pulled the case. Not this. So the federal judge that we'll see Monday, I've heard great things about. He's, I think, an Obama appointee or a I think he's an Obama appointee. But anyway, the judge who will preside over Fannie Willis's state case is also inexperienced. And I think Aileen Cannon's case is she's inexperienced, but she's also easily persuaded by Stan Woodward, which, you know, I've seen a lot of Stan Woodward has been playing the press for 2.5 years on the January 6th investigation. And there are a lot of journalists who've been very credulous of his claims. So he's good at that.
Yes. You know? Yes. So, okay. So, Marcy, in the few minutes we have left, I've got three stories here. One is, and you wrote about it early this morning, my time, before we started recording this, and it has to do with the Republicans' favorite diversion, Hunter Biden. And the headline is, right-wing operatives say Hunter Biden shouldn't get same treatment as Dmitry Firtash. Is their response to everything Donald Trump, Hunter Biden?
Yes. Yeah. And like I said, if you are a Fox News viewer, all you know is that Hunter Biden and Joe Biden are the most corrupt presidents in the world. And these people believe it. I mean, they literally believe it. And unless you understand what has gone into that process. And the problem is that DC journalists, you know, Kevin McCarthy can say, oh, yeah, we'll go impeach because we have no evidence against Joe Biden. And rather than reporting, oh my gosh, Republicans admit they have no evidence, and the response to that is impeachment.
Right.
They present it as a process question. We're closer to impeachment. And so that's what's like, I'm as worried about really terrible Hill reporting in DC as I am about what Fox News is to brainwash these people, because you know, this terrible reporting in DC is reporting stuff that is completely counter to democracy, to rule of law, as if it's just process.
Right.
As if it's just normal legislative process, and it's not. And it is completely ridiculous that they can't bother themselves to do better coverage.
Yeah, the Washington Post this morning is reporting that that they're talking about, yes, going ahead with an impeachment, or at least an impeachment inquiry into Joe Biden, quote, on the idea that the evidence is being hidden. So that's, yeah. They don't have evidence. They're just saying, well, it's being hidden. But in the next breath, Comer, who heads the committee, bragged about receiving, quote, 100% of the documents he requested. So if they've given over 100% of the documents he's requested, what are they hiding?
And that's the point. I mean, McCarthy pretends that he's asking for bank information. Comer has gotten the bank information. He's going to pretend now that Joe Biden is hiding State Department information. But the other point is, like, if you look at Trump's two impeachments, if you look at the Ukraine impeachment, then, you know, Trump didn't turn over anything.
Nothing.
State Department didn't turn over. Defense Nothing. Department didn't turn over. Ways and Means didn't turn over. Like, they didn't turn over anything. So the entire premise is false. And the problem is, journalists are not saying, first of all, you have no evidence.
Right.
You have no evidence.
Right. And they admit they have no evidence. They don't. Right.
Right. So.
Okay, so there's that hypocrisy. Then, so that's going on. And of course, as you point out, Marcy Wheeler, the Fox viewers, all they know is what Fox is telling them, and they call it news, and they think that that's the truth, and they believe right. that shit. I feel sorry for them, but it goes back to Donald Trump saying, I love the poorly educated. Well, of course you do, because a dumbed down electorate is an easily pliable, manipulated electorate, yeah. right? And then the other big story this week, the plane crash in Russia, Prigozhin dead. And, you know, funny, I don't follow what Donald Trump writes on his Truth Social or anywhere else. Has he commented on his favorite, you know, world dictator, leader, genius guy, who obviously, in the debate the other night, none of them, except for Ramaswamy, had anything nice to say about Putin. They threw around the term murderer a lot. But has Trump weighed in on this?
Not that I've seen, no. I mean, and it's interesting. I mean, I think we're going to, the ramifications are going to hit, I think, Africa before they're going to hit Syria, before they're going to hit Ukraine. But it is interesting because obviously Prigozhin was one of the two ways that that Putin has intervened in past elections. And Putin is more interested in shoring up his own power at this point than, I mean, trust me, he's still fiddling in the United States, very much so. And that may be his one strong point right now. But it's unclear what we're going to see in the aftermath of Prigozhin. But it's not surprising he was killed. But it'll be interesting going forward.
Yeah, it will be. You know, there's one other little story that I'm just seeing little mentions of. Donald Trump quietly sold Mar-a-Lago to one of his spawn. For $422 million? What?
Yeah, we need to, I mean, like, hopefully there'll be more robust reporting on that because that is sort of Zillow based, so it's not particularly robust, but understand that there are multiple theories by which any property used in his crimes will be subject to forfeiture, as well as his super PAC. Right. So just the PAC money, I think, is more subject to forfeiture if Jack Smith ever puts together a false, you know, a fraudulent fundraising case against him. But the house itself, because it's not a house, it's, you know, it's a commercial property. Yes. My guess is that the house itself, Trump was advised that the house itself could be at risk for forfeiture if he didn't transfer ownership. And my guess it's the Georgia thing and not the federal thing because Don Jr. to whom he, you know, it's a company run a company, you know, like the Republicans are like, oh my God, Hunter Biden had a shell company. I'm like, have you looked at Mar-a-Lago? Like, have you looked at Trump's entire business model?
Yeah, look at the Alvin Bragg case, right? I mean, that's all that.
It's all shell companies, yes. Right? Donald Trump is nothing but a shell company with an ugly mug. But so it is a company managed by Don Jr. And my guess is that it was, if it in fact holds up, again, we need to see some more robust reporting. Right. But my best guess, and as I said, Trump swapped lawyers in Georgia for one of the best in the state on RICO. So my guess is that somebody got to him and said, like, you know, you need to get through this RICO prosecution before you can even imagine you're going to be able to win an election. And the RICO process, you know, there are strengths and weaknesses to both of the prosecutions, to all of the prosecutions against Trump, but the RICO has certain tools that Jack Smith is not yet using against Trump beyond. I mean, Jack Smith is using co-conspiracy law in the federal case to ensure that he doesn't have to put Rudy Giuliani on the stand or Sidney Powell or Boris Epstein or Kenneth Cheeseman. but Fannie Willis has more tools with the RICO indictment. And so my guess is that led somebody to advise Trump to start acting more like a criminal defendant and less like a con man.
Well, that comes naturally to him, I think. Marcy Wheeler, all right, I'm going to let you go in a second. I just have to do one postscript, not related to any of this. The debate the other night, Ron DeSantis, I, and again, maybe I'm not reading enough, but I'm surprised I haven't seen more outrage over this answer that he gave.
So as president, would you support sending U.S. special forces over the border into Mexico to take out fentanyl labs, to take out drug cartel operations? Would you support that kind of American military use?
Yes, and I will do it on day one.
Ron DeSantis is going to invade Mexico on day one of his pretend presidency and with troops? What?
This is a real Republican policy. I mean, there are people in Congress saying that you have to do it. And DeSantis, he's trying to find a place that he can run from. And it's as a fascist. And yeah, he's saying, but the other thing is that, like, Republicans have and Fox News have invested so much in treating the Mexican border as the source of all evil, in trying to simplify the fentanyl crisis down to border rather than down to transnational financial flows.
Yeah.
And they have, like, there's no room for complexity in the GOP anywhere anymore. And so what do you do if there's a problem? You bomb the shit out of it. And that is where that instinct comes from. Wow. Right. It's the same instinct, though, that says shut down one of the biggest employers in your state because
right.
they are friendly to gay employees.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. I'm just glad the rest of the country is finally seeing what I've been telling them about Ron DeSantis for the last 6 years. But the unbelievable part of it is in this Washington Post Ipsos poll that I mentioned before, and I know it's a poll, but it's on this debate that Republican voters thought he did the best. It's opposite world.
If it's the same poll that I'm thinking of, the other thing about that poll, or one poll, is it showed there was some movement among viewers. Like, people were like, oh yeah, maybe I could support DeSantis. Maybe I could support Ramaswamy. Although no women said that. Maybe I could support Nikki Haley. And so it's at least comforting that Republicans are saying, yeah, I could find some of these people tolerable if for whatever reason I couldn't vote for Donald Trump, because right. you need to see that movement. You need to see some people you need to give people a process by which they can remove themselves from the cult, even if it's a different cult. Like, you know, Ron DeSantis is unreconstructed fascism. Nikki Haley is just an old style neocon. But you need to, it's cult deprogramming at this point.
Yeah. Oh, good. All right. Well, the hour is up. We keep going, but we'll stop here. Marcy Wheeler, I know you're going on vacation, enjoying family time next week. But we will talk again very soon because we're going to do this regularly. And there's stuff coming up. So I thank you so much for sharing your reporting and expertise with us. I'm excited.
Always great to be on.
And with that, we're done. Have a great weekend, everyone. I'm Nicole Sandler. Thank you so much for listening. Be sure to visit emptywheel.net to stay up to date with all of Marcy's reporting. And check out our past shows anytime, anywhere, nicolesandler.com. It's all there. Support both of us if you can. I'll see you Monday. Have a great weekend.